Right, right here, okay?
Get away from me!
Well, just let me ride right here. Just let me write my name. I don't just write my name, man. Why not?
Because it was ridiculous.
BFK, man. BFK. Bumfuck crew, man. Right? Mm-hmm. Can I write it?
Just go ahead. Write the name.
Okay. I walk up to Memphis alone, 'cause you do it for me.
Because we so fervently believe that we must make average American lives a whole lot better.
Stimulate purchases. Restore prosperity. You have wasted precious days and weeks and years in futile discussion. We need action, immediate and effective action.
Mr. President, there is a movement in Congress for your impeachment. Hardly time for making any requests, however small.
Very well. I shall withdraw that request, but I would like to substitute another. I ask you, gentlemen, to declare a state of national emergency and to adjourn this Congress until normal conditions are restored. During the period of that adjournment, I shall assume full responsibility for the government.
Mr. President, this is dictatorship.
Senator Langham, words do not frighten me.
But the United States of America is a democracy.
We are not yet ready to give up the government of our past.
Murphy, order!
You have given it up. You've turned your backs. You've closed your ears to the appeals of the people. You've been traitors to the concepts of democracy upon which this government was founded. I believe in democracy, as Washington, Jefferson, and Lincoln believed in democracy. And if what I plan to do in the name of the people makes me a dictator, then it is a dictatorship based on Jefferson's definition of democracy, a government for the greatest good of the greatest number.
This Congress refuses to adjourn.
I think, gentlemen, you forget that I am still the president of these United States. And as Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, it is within the rights of the President to declare the country under martial law!
Martial law is in effect for the safety of all citizens. Groups of more than three men shall not congregate in public spaces. A curfew is in effect. Any person found on the street after dark will be subject to summary judgment. Long live General Gaius Julius Caesar! Savior!
Jupiter Optimus Maximus.
Where John D. left off and his discoveries, things that he was working on, that it has been passed on. It's still continuing today under other names. Alchemy and those things like that. They were mixing magic, science, and religion all together. It was just a melting pot. I also find it very interesting that a very famous Arthur C. Clarke, a science fiction writer, has a great quote that says, "Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic." And when you start researching and connecting the dots of what's going on with NASA, technology, the magic and of the Illuminati and music behind the Illuminati, the frequencies and tones, they are the builders. And nothing has changed. All it is has been repackaged under new names for our day and time. The next clip I'm going to play, I don't want to reinvent the wheel, but this is a great clip on John D. and when, you know, they picked up where he left off. And that is what CERN and D-Wave, part of the compartmentalization that is going on to communicate back and forth from one realm to the next. And once that doorway is opened all the way, you cannot shut it. It is you're going to let something into this realm that is not supposed to be in this realm. And it was put here by the Creator for a reason, for protection. Firmament over the earth, call it whatever you want. Please enjoy this clip. I'll be right back after this.
The discovery of the Hermeticum during the Renaissance created a new generation of occultists. They sought to combine religion with science and magic, a dangerous undertaking in a society ruled by Christianity. John Dee would risk his life to study its teachings.
John Dee was a giant. John Dee was the embodiment of the ideal of an enlightened being who had the spiritual understanding of his role and mission in life, and who was gifted with, you know, superior intelligence.
But like Pythagoras, he would pay a heavy price for daring to seek out the wisdom of the gods. The ultimate Renaissance man, Dee followed in the footsteps of Paracelsus, using experimentation to become a gifted scientist, an inventor, a mathematician, a brilliant cryptographer, and a pioneer in the field of navigation.
But he was also an occultist, he was a sorcerer, he was an astrologer, he was in fact Queen Elizabeth's personal court astrologer. And in that sense, his interests were all very much in keeping with the thinking of the time. There wasn't a distinction made between magic and science, and he was pursuing an understanding of the world around him.
When Queen Elizabeth rose to the throne of England in 1558, she installed Dee as court astrologer, but his influence reached far beyond his position. England's famous magician was also a spy for the Queen.
He was involved with political intrigue. He was a trusted ally of the Queen, but he was also working behind the scenes throughout Europe to helped to lower the power of the church and to substitute Protestant power in its stead.
With Dee's guidance, Queen Elizabeth officially legitimized the most significant occult science of the Renaissance, alchemy. Alchemists had two goals, to heal illness and to turn base metal into gold. They believed success could be achieved by finding the Philosopher's Stone, a mystical agent that would also produce a higher level of consciousness in the alchemist.
That was really an approach to trying to understand the way the physical world works, and alchemy as a practice, you know, was the forefather of modern chemistry.
Alchemy had existed since the early Egyptians, but in the hands of the Renaissance scientists, it reached new heights.
Everything that we know and do today in our modern science was developed by the alchemists. Laboratory techniques were part of the alchemical tradition. The observation of results, the scientific method, is a child of alchemy.
Alchemists were on the leading edge of science. They discovered phosphorus, zinc, the distillation of alcohol, the germ nature of diseases. They were the first to understand how blood circulates in the body. The church viewed their unorthodox experiments and scientific breakthroughs with growing suspicion.
We are speeding up what nature does. We're speeding up the rate at which the metals evolve. We're speeding up the rate at which medicines are combined and raise consciousness. And the church felt that you can't be speeding up God's creation without recourse to demons.
Despite his work in alchemy, Dee's true occult passion lay in divination. He believed that he could apply scientific methods to communicate with supernatural beings. Dee's obsession with contacting the angels would have disastrous consequences. This art of manipulating objects like bones, tea leaves, and tarot cards had arrived from the Muslim East in the 14th century and become a popular method of fortune telling. But Dee used a divination method known as scrying. Dee relied on looking into a crystal ball that would reflect back supernatural
TV.
Scrying is a long time old technique. Scrying into glasses, mirrors, bodies of water, anything that would have a reflective surface. And see if you could see not just the material things, but the spiritual things standing behind.
Dee's efforts were unsuccessful until one day a young man named Edward Kelly appeared at his door. Kelly seemed to have the talent to see into the shadow world.
Their system involved Edward Kelly looking into a amethyst crystal and describing what he saw, and John Dee would then record these communications.
Kelly began receiving messages from the angels. They spoke in a language he called Enochian, from the lost biblical book of Enoch. These transmissions are early examples of what New Age followers now call channeling.
What Dee and Kelly brought forth was completely new. It was not based on tradition.
He appeared to be speaking a new language.
The Enochian language does appear to have a coherent vocabulary and syntax, and this doesn't seem like the sort of thing that Kelly, who was not a particularly educated or schooled person, could have just invented. He couldn't have faked something like that.
John Dee and Kelly embarked on a tour of Europe to share their discoveries, just as the Inquisition launched another crackdown against heretics.
All you needed was a slight change in political or religious circumstance, and something that was considered exceptionally wonderful would then be considered demonic and scary.
Dee returned home to England to find that a mob had destroyed his irreplaceable library and scientific and occult instruments. Dee had fallen out of favor with the court. The man who began as a leading scientist of the Renaissance ended his life penniless, branded as a sorcerer.
Dee's main legacy was not to science, it is to magic. And it's because of those who have come after, who have seized upon what he created.
Housing would be easy. It's way more complex than, I mean, it would put Hell 9000 to shame.
John Dee's fall was the beginning of the occult's end. The practices were reviled by the church as the work of demonic possession. From the 14th through the 16th century, more than 40,000 people would be executed for witchcraft. Occult ideas became embedded in the traditions of secret societies, such as the Freemasons and the Rosicrucians.
They were tending to do them passed on among secret brotherhoods and organizations because these are very powerful and dangerous ideas, dangerous to status quo, dangerous to institutionalized religion. So there's an element of underground secrecy associated with some of these themes.
These havens of safety began to flourish across Europe. Secret societies were instrumental in the new age of enlightenment that swept through Europe in the 1700s and even helped in the founding of American democracy.
So there you have it, the Brotherhood. And that's part of the problem, and is most on the face of the earth do not believe in a Brotherhood. If you do believe in the Brotherhood, you're a conspiracy nut, wacko, whatever you want to say. But this still does exist. It goes by different names. Call it what you want. They're all Luciferian. It could be Bilderbergers, Illuminati, you know, Rosicrucianists back in the day, Freemasonry now at the top levels. So that's one of the problems. But also, you know, they mock us in movies, videos, in the news, Olympics. I mean, it's all over the place. That they're showing you who they are. You just have to learn their language. You know, centuries ago and throughout history, the octopus, Rothschild's octopus, the English throne, that was a symbol. The octopus was a symbol of having tentacles, so to speak, into everything, into money, trade, education, technology, whatever that was, science. The octopus has been a long, long time symbol of that, outreaching. There's plenty of good videos out there that talk of the symbolism of the octopus. I have one of those on my website as well. But, I mean, even just to show you how they mock us and put it in our face, you know, you've got the 2015 London Olympics. Right there, the octopus, the tentacles going out, and, you know, And someone, I don't know if anybody's touched on this, but notice that it's newspaper. Now, the stage is newspaper. N-E-W-S. That's code also for all over the world. The news, yes, but north, east, west, south. News. It's also on the Masonic tracing board as well, which, you know, that's a whole nother video. Stretched tentacles of the Brotherhood, the kingdoms of this world that have been given to Satan, and that's another problem, is Jesus was took up on a high mountain. Satan took him there, asked him to bow down, and if you worship me, I will give you the kingdoms of this world. And they still are for an age, and people have a big time problem with that. Sorry, you know, that's the plan for an age, even in the James Bond intros. And
Christ comes, he, not his church, he, the King of Glory, he will set up a kingdom.
The Knights Templars are at the heart of this conspiracy to rule the world, otherwise known today as the New World Order. Jesuits really are the revived Knights Templars.
These counterfeit crusades that they hold. So beware of these dangerous doctrines of demons that are coming into the church.
It's prophetic that God's using you to break things open. In Jesus' name,
Jeesuksen nimessä,
we declare the spirit of religion
me julistamme, että uskonnollisuuden
that blocks the glory, the head be cut off.
Että sen pää leikataan nyt poikki.
Decapitate.
He who occupies the top of those mountains can literally shape the agenda that forms nations.
This crusade, this war on terrorism.
The Knights Templars. In Jerusalem, the Templars began to deviate further and further away from the practices of Christianity. They learned the secret arts of the Kabbalah, an ancient form of Jewish magic, along with its dark rites and rituals. In 1717, the Templars made their reappearance in Europe. They had grown in both number and strength, and were now ready to coin a new identity, free from their reputation of the past, and given credibility by none other than the monarchy and aristocracy of England. And the name they chose for themselves was a name that would be known by many, but understood by a few. This new name, the Freemasons.
Now, at its very core, this issue seems to tie right into the Knights Templar. And I know that sounds very strange. The Knights Templar. And I know that sounds very strange from the get-go, but honestly, this deception that's coming into the church is actually tied to the Jesuit Knights Templar. The government of the Order of the Temple of Solomon. I mean, not only are we in the time where everyone's saying, you know, is there going to be a third temple? And then in 2013, it comes to light here that the Knights Templar are back, you know, for not that they ever went away, but they've come back into the public light. The Sovereign Magistral Order of the Temple of Solomon. 2013 AD. It's fully restored as an independent sovereign subject of international law in 2013, embodying the authentic Templar heritage. And we literally have a whole website here, which is dedicated to all of these official documents, legal documents, mind you, and their missions. This is what I want to show you, this Templar spirituality. And this is how this links with this deception that we're seeing, the worship of the goddess, the reverence of the divine feminine, Gaia. The temple rule proves that the Knights Templar were always dedicated to honoring the divine feminine principle as the spiritual feminine aspect of God. So you can see how this ties to the Roman Catholic Church, to the Jesuits, to Allah, the moon goddess, and to all of these false religions, but also this pagan New Age, which is actually the Old Age Babylon agenda. And the throwing out of this masculine, you know, we see all these attacks on God and the Old Testament and the truth of God and turning into this airy-fairy, emotional, experiential deal, without boundaries, without restrictions, without commands. And all of this stuff is tying into, when you come to its very core, the conspiracy at its very heart of the New World Order, the Antichrist, the paganism, the Babylon agenda, New World Order, is actually rooted in the Knights Templar, who never went away, but now in 2013 have officially come out into the public and declared themselves sovereign, a sovereign entity without territory, but sovereign nonetheless. So it's all about Gnosticism and Christian mysticism, the divine feminine. The uniquely ancient and diverse heritage of Templar spirituality was fully disclosed to the Vatican and officially endorsed by the Roman Catholic Church. Authentic Templar spirituality is a form of esoteric Gnosticism which is wholly compatible with the canonical Christian mysticism of classical Catholicism. Gnostic spirituality primarily concentrates on personal divine communion through the Holy Spirit. Here we go, look, Templar chivalry, look at this. This is the picture of the Pope with all the world leaders of religions, of false religions. Hinduism, Islam, Baha'i. And this is what they are showing. And at the bottom of the page, we can see all of these emblems, which say a lot. Pontifical protection. Recognized by five Vatican papal bulls as Templar guardians of the church. Cooperation with Islam. Look at that. Cooperation with Islam as a tool of the Jesuit Knights Templar. Look at this. The Knights of Saladin under Templar sovereign patronage. Diplomatic relations with the United Nations with the crest of Rome. Oh my goodness me. Look at this, United Nations. This is where all of these agendas are coming to. So, and remember with the United Nations that they have those books on New Age spirituality, Alice Bailey, and all of these people who were involved in this Gnostic counterfeit spirituality of the Antichrist. And this is very similar. This logo is very similar to what we see on some of the big Christian, so-called Christian, broadcasting networks at the very top. But with this fire and water. So we see on a lot of these big organizational level, a lot of Illuminati symbolism. And what it is essentially, remember with the Knights Templar, this is dominionism. This is dominion theology about taking over the world. So this explains the influx of false doctrine of Jesuit infiltrators into churches, into the mainstream Christian media, and all with this core belief of the Holy Grail, the divine feminine Gnosticism that they are really pushing onto churches and losing those boundaries. That they're advertising it as something like in Hollywood, you know, we need to get out of this box and we need to, you know, forget all the old stuff. We need to free ourselves, liberate ourselves, liberals, liberation from the old into this new spirituality, which is a lot more humanistic and it's a lot more divine, and you feel more, you experience more, and that's the cheese on the trap that they're trying to pull people in. I mean, yes, there are certain good things to Reformation, but they are staging a counterfeit Reformation, which is a Knights Templar Gnostic Reformation, and they're pulling people into these horrific scenes which I showed at the beginning of this with Bethel Music and all of these people that have counterfeit counterfeit revivals, counterfeit prophecies, counterfeit signs and wonders, these groups that are actually pushing a kundalini spirit, these you know, these counterfeit crusades that they hold at the, you know, these top levels, which are coaxing and coercing people into a counterfeit spirit. False light and the two pillars through the Twin Towers and with the Building 7, so you get them pillars, you get those pillars coming down, you got the figure in the center of it bringing these down and collapsing Building 7, which would be the cornerstone, the cube, just like we said about the cube fell open behind the veil in Herod's temple. The cube fell open when Jesus was crucified and the veil broke. Well, it's the same thing. It's the exact same thing. Except this time, this is coming from within the womb. This is coming the other way. This is coming out. Everything of Christ is inverted with the Antichrist. So this is what you get. The two towers, the twin towers, the veil, and you'd get this Isis figure on the cube there, see, on the cornerstone, coming through the veil from the other way. And it's about breaking it out of the womb. It's about breaking the fallen out. All of this coming through the veil. Samsung G. Samsung, son of Sam. Samael. Samael. Another name for Satan. Samael, son of Sam. So, Samsung, break this word up, Samsung, between those pillars, like Samson, Samsung, son of Sam, Samsung, the G between the two pillars in Freemasonry, within the IXXI, pushing down the two pillars, the son of Sam, pyramid there in the logo for Samsung. And it comes from the womb of Saturn. If you don't believe me, if you think that's absolutely ludicrous, well, just keep looking at the evidence, which is all around us. Look at this album cover, just for one example. Dizzy Wright, look at this. You see there how round the edges it's got the vinyl? Well, the vinyl round the edges stands for the rings of Saturn. So you can see on this album cover called The Golden Age, which is many will know what that is, the Golden Age of Saturn, the return to Eden. So you've got the rings of Saturn round the outside. You've got this lady, this woman in the center. It's about Cain's house, you know. Coming through that door, she's pregnant. She's pregnant, so this is coming out of the womb. So there you've got right there, this is coming out the womb, which is in Saturn. You've got the mother there with a pregnant belly. The Golden Age, the whole thing is transfigured to gold. So it's the transfigured ox, the transfigured, the belly of the beast. This is what, this is shown time and time again. Directly as a contributing factor to the outpouring of the cup of sin, the increase of sin in the world, which is a belief they have. Sabbatai Zevi, the Frankists, the belief that they need to fill this cup of sin, the increase of sin, this cup of filth in the world, in order to birth their Messiah, what they think is the real Christ, what they believe is the Messiah. But we know that it is the Antichrist. It is not the true Christ, because these people don't necessarily believe that what they are doing is a false doctrine of the devil, is a doctrine of demons. And that's exactly what it is, the birthing of this new age of Antichrist.
the falling cross, like turning the cross upside down, the tree, the cross. And you see that this is kind of a spiritual reference because it's in this shawl, this white shawl here. And you can see that it's that same kind of spirit reference. This is a spiritual thing breaking through the veil. And we go to her on this journey, the cracking through time and space, as all of these, like Inception, the Inception movie, where gravity begins to change, the chaos begins, terrorism, war, the collapse of society, ripping the firmament, and like this sun child, you can see even there the reference to the sun directly behind this. It's the sun child, Tammuz, Nimrod. I mean, this has been the goal since the Tower of Babel. This light coming into the darkness, but in a counterfeit way. This is an inversion of Christ. This is a copy of the truth. As always, the pagan sun god. This is what Zeitgeist, this is the one they claim is Jesus, is actually Jesus, but that's the lie. You see how you can see that all of this propaganda has been lies from the very beginning, calling, you know, trying to merge the Babylonian mystery religion and say that this is all that, you know, this is what Jesus was, a pagan sun god. No, this is the pagan sun god, and it is not the real Jesus. It is the IHS, sun king, Antichrist. So you see that it goes into like bullet time, kind of an anti-gravity thing, everything being turned upside down. You see through that truck there, the way that tears in the background, you can see that it's like the birthing, the giving birth, the breaking through the veil. Even on the truck, you've got the red and the blue here, the pushing down of the pillars, which is all the same references of the new age, the dawning of the golden age, the new age of Antichrist. And the choir in the background, you know exactly what this is referencing. And the peaceful music from the chaos, the order out of this chaos. The false peace. The Bible tells us that there's going to be a false peace. But these people don't know, they don't realize that they've been deceived, beguiled by Lucifer into this Luciferian doctrine, which they believe that the true Christ is to come. But we know that the true Christ walked this earth 2,000 years ago. So in effect, this is ISIS and this chaos, bringing this, you know, running through this chaos, the terrorism, the war that's going on in this world, which we're seeing a lot of, the gradual collapse of society, birthing this false peace, this dawning of the new age. Isis and the Horus sun child weeping for Tammuz. You see the reference there in her eye. You see the tear beginning to form in her eye, weeping for Tammuz. And she overcomes. She overcomes this chaos. In their false doctrine, this would be referred to as overcoming the serpent, overcoming time, cracking through time and space. The woman running through. And also the dawning of this apostate religion of uniting the world under this false Christ, the ecumenical movement of coexist, of the Islamic false Christ, of the Catholic IHS false Christ, of merging everyone into this one world of unity, the light coming into the darkness and into the chaos. The male child is born, Tammuz Nimrod. Their whole belief system is centered around this. And you see these quick flashes as these birth pangs come to a head, These quick flashes, you'll see the single eye reference as per usual. You know exactly where this is coming from. This is Illuminati, Kabbalistic propaganda, Saturnalian, the son of Saturn. Just that familiar single eye, which we're all pretty used to seeing them using now, in this demonic deception. And she's delivered this baby from the heart of the earth, the worthless shepherd, the one-eyed shepherd. They're even referencing the one eye on the baby there. The mother goddess birthing Nimrod from the heart of the earth. And are we not seeing this all over the world, repeatedly, seemingly increasingly, all over the world, that this same agenda is being shown, the gradual breakdown of society, order out of chaos, because of the increase in wickedness, the love of many shall grow cold. CERN, the CERN agenda, the tree falling down, the new age of Antichrist. Changing times and laws. The apostate Babylonian New Age religion being birthed into the earth. This is exactly what I was saying in the last video, the collapse of society in order to bring in the false messiah that will mislead many with itching ears. It looks so good, it looks so right, because it's the Hegelian dialectic of the good, false good versus evil. But it's all a deception.
Then suddenly the whole world will believe in Christ.
Now these seven fields of influence are very powerful, so powerful in fact, that he who occupies the top of those mountains can literally shape the agenda that forms nations. Can literally shape the agenda that forms nations.
What you're going to watch is a video about the true conspiracy solved at last. This is the conspiracy. This is the final revelation that can be brought out. This is the revelation. I've spent the last few years going into the Jesuits and really going into the history of the Jesuits and how they infiltrated the Vatican and how they destroyed the office of the Pope of Rome and how they had complete control of the cardinals and the bishops and really used the Vatican to bring their wars and revolutions to overthrow all governments and to have the Pope of Rome worshipped as the universal monarch and king of the world. And that's the revelation. And then also I found out that Pope Francis is in fact the Black Pope. He is the superior Jesuit general. It is the Black Pope that's controlled the Vatican for hundreds of years. He is the one that rules over all the Vatican knighthoods. He rules over all the Jesuit alumni, presidents and prime ministers. And Pope Francis is also the Grand Master of the Knights Templars. Let me explain this. Here you have the cross, and you have the Templar seal, which is the Lamb of God holding the cross. But there's more to this picture than meets the eye. There's a lot of hidden revelation in these symbols, and the fact that he's holding this cross. Now, this is the seal of the Knights Templars. Why is Pope Francis holding this cross? Because this Templar seal is the revelation. It is the Lamb of God that holds the cross. Here we have the Pope of Rome claiming to be the Lamb of God. That's what he's doing. This is a clear revelation to those in the Brotherhood of the Templars that really Pope Francis, as the Grand Master of the Knights Templars, is holding up this Templar seal of the Lamb of God holding the cross, while he also is holding a cross as the Grand Master of the Templars, also the Black Pope of the Jesuits of Rome. He's in the place of Christ. He's anti-Christ. He's replaced Christ as head of the church. Now this makes perfect sense. When also you read the book of Revelation 17. Quote, Revelation 17, verse 16. And the 10 horns which you saw upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and will make her desolate and naked, and will eat her flesh and burn her with fire. So here we have that great city, the whore of Revelation, on seven hills, Rome, destroyed by the beast. So when you bring out the revelation that the Pope is Antichrist, people say, well, why would the Pope destroy his own church? Well, I'm going to explain this and it'll make perfect sense. The reason why the Pope of Rome in the future will be the one to destroy the Vatican, even though the world won't know that, they won't know that, it will be an attack from some other source. And they will attack the papacy and destroy the Vatican. And Pope Francis, of course, will then be positioned at the Temple Mount. I'll explain that later on in the video. But going into the motivation of the Antichrist, the beast destroying the papacy, it makes perfect sense when you look at Jacques de Lamoy. He was the Grand Master of the Templars. And of course, he was burned at the stake after being tortured endlessly, of course. And so the Templars were not destroyed. They have a vendetta against the Vatican. Their agenda was to create the Jesuit order. It's just a front for the Templars. And then to really infiltrate the Vatican. And then control through the office of the infallibility of the Pope and his temporal political power all nations of the earth, which the Pope does today. And then ultimately bring down the great whore. Destroy her, burn her with fire, leave her desolate. That's what's coming next. Also, it makes perfect sense when you consider the fact that according to Daniel chapter 9, the Antichrist goes into the third Jewish Hebrew temple and stops the sacrifices and oblations. And according to Revelation, he also makes war against the saints. Where was it the Templars were founded? The Temple Mount. Where was the headquarters? The Temple Mount. Full circle. They're going right back. That's why the Templars already control Israel. It's the Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem. It was created by the Templars working through the British Templar Crown. Understand that the Crown, British Empire, is not controlled by the monarchy, but the Templars of the inner corporation city of London, the Temple Bar, Temple Ground. And it was through the British Templar Crown they opened up Palestine, and they used the Rothschilds to fund the settlements. They're merely Knights of Malta. And so here we have the Templars in control of the Vatican, in control of Israel. It is this order that will bring forth the Antichrist. It was the Templars that created the Jesuits. Look at this picture of Pope Francis again. I'm going to go really deep into this video. I mean, this is the revelation. There's two revelations coming forth in this picture. As I said previously, I want to open them up more. The first revelation is that he is a Templar. He is the Grand Master of the Knights Templar. When you hold up the cross in this way, of the Lamb of God holding the cross, which is a Templar seal, this is an open revelation. Obviously, it's closed to millions and millions and millions of people, but to those at the highest levels of this world government, they will understand this. This is the Grand Master, the Black Pope of the Jesuit Order, the Grand Master of the Knights Templar, in the place of the Lamb of God. He is proclaiming himself as the Lamb of God. You see, the Templars, let me explain something. They never believed that Jesus was the Son of God. They never believed that he was even God himself. They never believed that he was divine. They never even believed that he was a prophet. They believe he died on the cross because of his own ministry and his own sins and his own false prophecies. That's what the Jesuits really believe. The Templars don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. You saw the Antichrist in history is in the place of Christ. He's in the place of Jesus Christ himself. That's right. That's the revelation of the Antichrist. The vicar of Christ means to replace and be in the place of. Antichrist also really means the same, to be against Christ. But who would suspect that the Bishop of Rome, the head of the Christian Catholic Church, would be the Antichrist? How can he be against Christ? How could the Pope be the Antichrist? You know, that's ridiculous. And people, that's the natural response. And it's a natural response. I understand that response. How could the Pope of Rome be the Antichrist? No, he'd be the false prophet. Listen, the popes in Rome put to death the church. The word of God declares to us that she is drunk on the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus. Well, that was in history. What's going on today, covertly, secretly, the Vatican's working through all of their, you know, intelligence community worldwide to continue to wage their wars of counter-reformation and bring war on the saints and the martyrs of Jesus. But what they're doing at the moment, the Templars are opening up the whole Middle East, destroying all Muslim opposition, really all opposition in the Middle East, in order to, you know, rule and govern their world government and one world religion from the Temple Mount. And that's what will happen. Originally, the third temple will be for Orthodox Judaism. And then the Pope, the Black Pope. Let me explain something. You know, just to move into something else. This is the first time in history we have this situation where we have a Grand Master of the Knights Templar, who is the Jesuit General, as the White Pope of Rome. He's the Black Pope, he's the White Pope. But hidden beneath this is also the revelation that he's the Grand Master of the Knights Templar. This conspiracy goes deep. Honestly, just when I think I've figured it out, just when I think I've got it all together, and, you know, I can see the whole picture, then, you know, God just brings more revelation. God just opens doors of understanding and you know, gives the keys. Because this is what God is doing. God is revealing to his church right now. He's revealing to his people who the man of sin is, who they are. And he's opening up this revelation to his people. And he's giving them revelation knowledge, because it comes by revelation, but also the information is there on the internet. It's there for people to find, but there's so many agents and there's so many gatekeepers, you know. And also it just takes a lot of research. I mean, to find this revelation, I believe that for a long time Adolfo Nicholas Patcham was the Black Pope, but then when Pope Francis was positioned, it was very clear to me that he was the Jesuit General, the Father General, not Adolfo Nicholas Patcham. He was the Black Pope. And the reason for that is because we had Hans Kornbach resign as the Jesuit General in 2008. Adolfo Nicholas Patcham positioned, Pope Benedict resigned, and Pope Francis has been positioned as a high Jesuit provincial. This has never ever happened before in the history of the Catholic Church or the Jesuit order. But I won't go into that. I'll just go into the Templar revelation and finish this video. We have a Black Pope today, Pope Francis. He is the Grand Master of the Knights Templars. And that really does make perfect sense, that he would be the man of sin, because the Templars hate the Catholic Church for what they've done to them. You know, for 3 years they were tortured. 3 years, you know. And a lot of them did escape. But they had headquarters all over the earth, in Paris and London, in you know, Cyprus, you know, in Spain, all over the earth, many other places. The Jesuits had headquarters known as the Temple. And they controlled the wealth of the world. They created the banking system. And it's the Templars, really, who are the ones that really created the Jesuit order through the Alumbrados and through the, you know, papal bloodlines of Italy, the Roman nobility bloodlines. And so people expose the Jesuits. I've been doing that for actually 3 years now on the internet, exposing the Jesuits, that it is the Jesuit General that controls the Vatican. And then suddenly we have a Jesuit general, you know, who is the Pope of Rome. But more than that, they are the Templars. That is why they will destroy the Vatican. That is why they will burn and leave desolate the city on seven hills. But of course, the Jesuits know that they're about to do this. And they obviously prepared the way by bringing out that Malachi prophecy, which is disinformation, you know, so people put their faith in that. But it did prophesy the destruction of the city on seven hills, and that the Pope of Rome would shepherd the flock. You know, so the Pope of Rome, you know, people won't know that he's destroyed it. They won't even know that he's the Grand Master. Now, if, you know, this Pope dies, then another one will take his place. He also will be the Grand Master. He also will be the Jesuit General. He also will be the Black Pope, hiding and masquerading behind the papacy. Catholics, if you only knew the beast that is buried in to this Catholic system. This is Antichrist. Think about it. It makes perfect sense. The Templars, the headquarters were at the Third Temple. Obviously, it wasn't built at that time. There was no temple there. But their headquarters was at the Temple Mount. This is what this is all about. It's about the Templars destroying the Vatican, burning her, leaving her desolate, and then moving its throne to Jerusalem.
And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth.
Pope Francis, the head of the Jesuit order, announced through his canter the imminent emergence, the near advent of the coming to light of the Antichrist.
Flamma Seius, Lucifer Matutinus inveniat, ille in quam Lucifer qui nescit ocaso, Christus filius tuus, qui regressus ab inferis, humano generis serenus illuxit, et te convivit et regnat in saecula saeculorum.
During this pronouncement, the cantor
individual, too much power for an immature species.
Building a legacy involves figuring out what is wanted and what needs to be done for that goal. All this you used to struggle with. Now, we think for you.
We are your guardians, after all.
You want to control human thought? Human behavior?
Of course. Anything can be quantified nowadays.
If you notice here, it says Q is a clearance. Okay, it has to do with clearance. Q is access authorization for the Department of Energy. Okay? So, Q, Anon, or Anonymous, Q is supposed to be about clearance. Okay? So, this information that's coming out, that's coming through so-called Q, I think it's kind of interesting that also this has to do with clearance, okay, which has to do with data. That's pretty interesting. But what's even more interesting than that, and I wonder if anybody else out there has connected these dots, is that IBM just announced their quantum Q system 1. You think that's a coincidence? IBM is calling their quantum computer that is now the first integrated quantum computer. It's being called Q. I don't think that's by chance. And I don't think it has to do with the fact that quantum starts with Q. I think there's something much more nefarious going on here. Do y'all remember that IBM was working with Nazi Germany? So here you have the Q system, the first quantum computer. And by the way, it's all about computation. Computers, right? Computer. Or computing numbers. And remember this, that's exactly what the Bible describes with the mark of the beast, right? The number, his number, the number of the beast, or the number of his name. And that's exactly what this system is all about. But what's even more interesting is that this thing is connected to CERN. There it is, right there, CERN.
It's over, and it ain't over yet.
To put their hands on the arc of history and bend it once more toward the hope of a better day.
The folks responsible for CERN are illumined, Luciferian. They're going for the big win.
Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them.
Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things, which thou knowest not.
You've got to take some of these things with a pinch of salt, because they're not all explicitly biblical, but certainly their belief is that these entities are trapped in Saturn, and it's all to do with breaking time and cracking them out. Of course, CERN as well, and all of that.
Of time.
Time is not someone you want as your enemy.
So time is a he, again, demonizing the masculine side. And this is likely a reference to Saturn there, because it goes the Tower of Babel, Stargate, time change, and then what do we get? We get the single eye symbolism. So there's probably a reference to that.
He is not someone you want as your enemy.
Young lady.
Looks like 1,000 points of light, all Luciferian.
This cannot be good.
The heart of the earth there, you see that? It all ties into the heart of time, the heart of the earth, and cracking them out. Through a portal. And that's it. This is the same thing. I mean, I haven't seen the film yet. This trailer's only just come out. But you see there how this is all tying into the same thing. The changing of time, the Luciferian belief system, Lucifer cracking out, the false light, cracking them out of the heart of the earth, and all of that.
I present you with a gift.
This is rather sick, actually. because I'm sure some of you can see what that represents right there, the king being beheaded. So this is very blasphemous, and it's also probably a reference to the king's children, for example, the propaganda surrounding Christians. And also in the book of Revelation, it tells us that Christians in the end times will be persecuted in like manner.
And are you ready for the Great Reset? Well, you should be, because whether you're ready or not, it's coming. What you're looking at here are sculptures that originated from ancient Egypt. They're currently being held at the British Museum in London. We see here a human in the center of two Nephilim hybrids, half man, half beast. The symbolism of the beast system always gives it away. In this picture, in these ancient sculptures from Egypt, we find the kneeling, we also find the fist raised. This is evidence of that same spirit that ran ancient Egypt. What we're actually seeing here is that same Antichrist spirit from Egypt manifesting in America. Currently in America, there's a movement where many millions of people are taking a knee. We are also finding movements where there are millions of people in America raising the fist. The narrative that's in place behind these symbolic gestures has nothing to do with the actual spirit that is behind these movements and these symbols. In all nations where communist politicians and insurgents operate, these evil men and women invariably identify themselves by making the sign of the clenched fist. Some biblical authorities say that the clenched fist also represents the rebellious attitude of the people of Babylon towards the Lord God. Dr. Peter Ruckman wrote that you will find this salute being given by all members of the Communist Party in New York in the 1920s and by the Stalinist Abraham Lincoln Brigade during the Civil War in Spain in the 1930s. This salute was adopted by the Black Panthers in America during the 1960s. Liberal Afro-American leaders continue to employ this salute to this day. The clenched fist salute or hand sign is also well known in Freemasonry. It's called the first sign or due guard. In the ritual of the select master degree is the holding up or raising of both arms in an L or square position with the fists of both hands typically clenched. Richardson's Monitor of Freemasonry states, the signs of a select master are then given as follows. The first is similar to the sign of a master mason. The fists are both clenched in allusion to one of the penalties of the obligation, which is to have both hands chopped off to the stumps. And here we find another interesting symbol that connects Freemasonry with ancient Egypt. A detailed study of ancient Egyptian religious literature provides us with tons of useful information on topics of witchcraft and divine powers. Magic, sorceries, and spells also formed a large part of ancient Egyptian society. It's as I always say, the symbols will tell the rest of the story. There is a language of symbols, ancient, it's been with us since the very beginning. And here we're finding those connections between ancient Egypt, which worshipped the sun god, or Lucifer, openly, and the mass amounts of chaos taking place in our modern day society. All of these people are being controlled by the same Antichrist spirit. And the sad part is, the majority of them have no clue. Anyone who has actually studied Freemasonry, or perhaps been a Freemason themselves, understand the connection between ancient Egypt, the mystery schools, the mystery religions, and modern Freemasonry. The connections here can be very diverse, and the study of this connection between Egypt and Freemasonry can get very deep. It's my opinion, in keeping it simple, that the ultimate connection between modern Freemasonry and ancient Egypt is that worship of the sun god. I also believe that many of these Masons and other secret societies on very high levels are doing the devil's work on this earth. Both the ancient Egyptians and modern Freemasonry at higher levels are working to form that one world order system, with a one-world leader. This ancient spirit of Egypt manifests in a myriad of ways all around the world. It's not just in America. We can find the same symbolism right here. This is from a nuclear security summit that took place in 2014. Obama was there with leaders from all around the world. And as you can see, they're sitting in a circle. And just inside the circle that they're sitting at, you can see modern-day hieroglyphics all around. And what do we find right in the center? A massive pyramid on top of a sun disk. This is a direct connection back to that system or that spirit of ancient Egypt, the mystery schools, the mystery religions.
I warn you, Holmes, if you pursue this matter...
Charles, in the pursuit of criminals, one learns their devices.
What is this mumbo-jumbo?
The handshake and the ring, Watson, are archaic rituals preserved by the 33rd degree members of the secret order of Freemasons.
Now there's something else I want to show you. What you're looking at is a map of Egypt, and what you see right there in the center is the Nile River. And the Nile River runs the entire length of Egypt. On the east side, it's about 30% of land, and on the west side, about 70%. The Nile River is also called the...
Still in Bern, Switzerland, obelisks. The all-seeing eye. And the famous statue of the Swiss pedophile. They call it the child eater. Well, that's what the sisters of ISIS want. You know, if they can't make a garden gnome out of him. And then they use drugs or... The Swiss pedophiles. So this is the famous Swiss pedophiles. It's the country is well known for pedophiles, as they had children, slaves, and all that. Here we can see the joining, the Swiss cross, and all that. Yeah, little monkeys. Oh, the bear. So here's still the bear. You know, from the Revelations, the beast. One of the beasts is the bear.
I want to see a Swiss system. I mean, I wouldn't mind being conquered by Switzerland right now.
A good person has sent me this. Excellent. This is octagon everywhere. There's a G. The Templar's G. You know, hidden in it. The Swiss Templar's cross. The all-seeing eye. Octagon.
This is the Swiss cross again. This is Alex Jones's stuff with a V of the Templars. It's all hidden in here. And here too, the Templars cross and a Swiss cross in the middle of it. And I'm very sure you'll find more things in it as well, you know. It's all hidden. Symbols don't lie. And this guy here who's supposed to know all these things, he's telling us about it. I mean, why is he using it? Eh? It even says, you know, this is quite cynical, open up your eyes. So cynical.
And now we go to a map of America. And what do we find in America? The Mississippi River. And the Mississippi River runs the entire length of America. On the east side, about 30% of the land. On the west, about 70% of the land. It's also interesting to note that the Mississippi River is considered the cradle of American civilization. And here's something else to take note of. Looking back at the map of Egypt, looking back at the Nile River, we find a city on the river called Memphis. And of course, in America, we also have a city named Memphis that sits on the Mississippi River. And it just so happens to have a massive pyramid in the city as well. It also has a statue of Ramses the Great in front of the pyramid. Even taking a look at American currency, we notice the two triangles, the pyramid and the capstone above it. The top capstone of the pyramid is not in place, and that's for a reason. It's denoting an unfinished situation. The capstone is detached from the bottom portion. And interestingly, the Great Pyramid of Egypt was never finished. So this unfinished situation was planned to remain in effect until the old world order was destroyed and replaced with a new world order.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.
But this still does exist. It goes by different names. Call it what you want. They're all Luciferian. It could be Bilderbergers, Illuminati, you know, Rosicrucianists back in the day, Freemasonry now at the top levels. So that's one of the problems. But also, you know, they mock us in movies, videos, in the news, Olympics. I mean, it's all over the place. That they're showing you who they are. You just have to learn their language.
Bother you because you're human, and I was human. I am human still.
Of this Antichrist androgynous figure. You know, where else have we seen this very same thing recently? This Rolling Stone magazine cover, Paris Jackson. This Antichrist figure, it looks very similar to Lady Gaga there, but this androgynous aspect, the symbolism with the hand, the false Christ symbolism, Rolling Stone, like the stone that rolled away from the tomb. So this is the same thing. So Lady Gaga is essentially playing Lucifer. But let's have a look at some of the stuff in here. I mean, it opened up where she's singing God Bless America. And she's singing on top of the stadium. I think this was made by drones. This is representing the 1,000 points of light in their symbolism. Lucifer in the heavens, like the Bible says, I will raise my throne above the stars of God. We've got the red and the blue symbolism, the two pillars of Freemasonry. So it's talking about this Hegelian land, because if we know anything, we know that the Freemasonry, the symbolism, like the all-seeing eye on the dollar bill, the secret societies that have been involved in America and all of those things. So really, you know, when she's speaking about God here, the God of Freemasonry is Lucifer. But this whole thing is that same, I mean, she's playing that mother goddess Isis. Under God. She's playing that Isis figure. And you can see that same split between the demiurge, the Gnostics' belief, the lesser god, and this female god. Because some of the songs she sings are actually kind of about that, which we'll get onto in a second. So what does she do? She starts off up here, and then she falls. She falls. She's cast out. She goes down. She's cast out from the stars, just like in the Book of Revelation. She's cast down into the stadium. I mean, this is what this is showing, yeah? The fall of Lucifer. I mean, yeah, it's... To me, it's just crazy. And then she comes on this tower, like this tower of, what do you call it in Lord of the Rings? That dark tower in Lord of the Rings, in that hellish place, was it Mordor? And you see that everything that was like an eye on the top, she's on the top. She's on the top. Well, Lucifer is on the top. And you see that everything changes at this stage, in the stadium. It all goes very smoky, like hellish. I'm on the edge of glory. Think about the lyrics and what they mean. Everything turns red. You see there? I can't play it too long because of obvious reasons. YouTube's very difficult these days. But so you get all this smoke of the pit. You get the red hellish symbolism. She's on top of that tower. I mean, look at this. So she's come from that top with 1,000 points of light up in the stars, and she's cast down into the stadium, and everything turns red and hellish and smoky like Mordor, like hell. She is on the tower, and suddenly the atmosphere's changed, and she's like in this kingdom of hell, and she's on the tower. What I see going on here, you see the stars. I mean, yes, that looks like a pentagram that's half buried or whatever, but and the pillars in the background. But look, this is like a dimensional plane. This is a dimensional plane. I saw someone say that it was a checkerboard floor. I mean, maybe they have links to that, but this is not essentially what this is representing. This is representing a dimensional thing, because this is a spiritual thing. This is about Lucifer, the Antichrist, planes of existence, the fall of Lucifer being cast out from the stars, because she was singing about God when she was up in the stars, right, before she was cast down. So she was singing about God, remember, and then she was cast down to the earth, and through these planes of existence, you see all of this going on. So you can see that it's a spiritual planes of existence. I mean, but if you listen to every song she sings, like about a poker face, which is essentially lying. A poker face is a false front. I was born this way. I mean, go and listen to it sometime. Listen to the song she's singing. Listen to the words she's saying. That she's playing. Remember, she's playing this androgynous Antichrist figure. This hybrid figure. And she wears a lot of stuff in it that is very similar to what the Bible describes with the precious stones. There's one costume Gons Rumera said about one of the costumes is very similar to the Bible's description of Lucifer before the fall and all of this. So she's playing that Antichrist Lucifer figure. Sophia, the bringer of wisdom, the fall of light, all of those things. And this is their hope, you know. This is the main reason for doing this video, is to warn you that this charismatic figure is representing a great deception that many, many people in this world are falling for already, because you can see how people are flocking to it. So when the real thing comes upon this earth that poses as light, it looks good, that is a great deception, because many will fall for it. So you see, this is like a fractal planes of existence, dimensional, cracking open of the matrix. This represents the same thing. You see the smashed glass behind her head. That's the cracking open of the matrix, the cracking of the veil, the dimensional veil, coming through the dimensional veil. So this is the costume. Yeah, I mean, the adorned in this gold and silver and precious stones. So this thing looks, to the eye, looks, you know, very good, which is the great deception. Caught in a bad romance. Okay, yeah, this the last moments of this performance of caught in a bad romance is very reminiscent of this, you know, Gnosticism, this belief and religion that they have. They basically believe about this bad romance between the demiurge and the mother figure. But when it comes down to it, when it really comes down to it, this, to make it simple, this is the Lucifer figure. This is Lucifer. This is the devil singing to the real God in heaven, the real creator, about this so-called bad romance, that they've fallen out of love and all of this. If you listen to some of the lyrics that she's saying in it, you really, caught in a bad romance, you really get that perspective that this is the devil. It's, you know, sympathy for the devil. If you read the Bible, you'll see that the devil is the father of all lies. The masquerader masquerades as light. So do not get drawn into that. I want your loving and I want your revenge. You and me could write a bad romance. As I say, she's playing that Isis figure. There's a lot of symbolism here, the eyes, eye symbolism, and you see here, she gets elevated on these two pillars in white. So this whole thing is like the fall of Lucifer, the rebellion against God,